Love and marriage, love and marriage, they go together like a horse and carriage. This I'll tell you, brother, you can't have one without the other. Love and marriage, love and marriage, it's an institute you can't disparage. Ask the local gentry, and they will say it's elementary. Try, try, try to separate them, it's an illusion. Try, 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 and you will only come to this conclusion. Love and marriage, love and marriage, they go together like the horse and carriage. Dad was told by mother, you can't have one, you can't have none, you can't have one without the other.
Hello and welcome to this week's food webinar. We figured you needed another dose of cuteness with the puppies, so there you go. I actually get to see the puppies tomorrow. They're coming in for a checkup and their next vaccine, so I'm really excited. So welcome to webinar number 9, and we are slowly getting through all of our Chinese medicine food therapy. We have one more week to go, and that's going to be on draining damp. And then I think we will get into some more specific diseases, specific things that we want to treat. So certainly if you have suggestions or diseases that you specifically would like to talk about, then please send ideas to us and we will be more than happy to get those together. So feel free to type in questions as we go along, and we'll get started. So today we're going to talk about moving stagnation. And last week when we talked about phlegm, I said that stagnation really went along with that because the two really go hand in hand. So we'll be repeating a little bit of the information from last week, adding on to the information. And so it's still true, you are what you eat. Somebody sent me a great quote this week, which of course I can't remember, but it's sort of one of those, you can pay me now or you can pay me later. And that's really so true in veterinary medicine. For my clients who feed really, really healthy diets and, you know, the raw fed, the home cooked, the high moisture diets, the low processed foods, I don't have to do near as much work on those animals, and their veterinary bills are not nearly as staggering. So, you know, it really is true. If you can spend a little bit more money each week on feeding your pet correctly and with something that's really healthy for their particular condition, you will have a lot lower veterinary bills. And I don't know why I do this. I'm putting myself out of business, although I say that there's always going to be enough people feeding really awful dog foods that I'll never go out of business, so I don't have to worry about it. So what is real food? That's really what we're talking about. So again, fresh fruits and vegetables, locally sourced, organic if possible. And we're getting close to the end of our season here in New Jersey. It doesn't make me happy. Fresh meats, preferably without antibiotics and growth hormones and those sort of things added. If you can find grass-fed, so much healthier. I just read something again this week about the bacterial counts in meats that are from feedlot-grown cattle versus grass-fed cattle. So everybody who talks about the high salmonella and E. coli counts in meats, you know, when you culture them, the animals that come from feedlot situations, we're going to culture a lot more bacteria off of that meat than we are from the grass-fed beef. So really, really does make a huge difference in the end product. And again, whole grains, again, if you can find organic, great. And if you can't, well, do the best you can on that. Okay. So if we are using a processed food, if it's dry, semi-moist, remember we don't like that one. We're never going to feed that one, so we can X that one off the list. Dry, refrigerated rolls, canned, home-cooked, raw. So we can either add to the processed products or we can choose our processed product to help treat stagnation if we're having that as an issue. So what is stagnation? Stagnation is chi or blood that has become stagnant. It's not flowing smoothly through the body. Without chi, blood cannot move. So remember, chi is the energy force of the body. So it's kind of like the, you know, putting a dam. If we don't have any chi, we can't move the blood. The blood's just going to become stagnant and sit there. So if you remember when we talked about phlegm last week, you always have to add a chi tonic if you're trying to drain phlegm because you've got to get it moving. So chi or blood stagnation, how do we get there? It can be caused by frustration. Think about a pressure cooker. You build and build and build and build and build. And it's funny, Hugh and I were having a conversation this weekend because my daughter apparently went ballistic and her last name is Campbell. And we have this thing in the family that we joke about called Campbell rage. So the Campbell rage is you hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it. Everything's fine. Everything's fine. Everything's fine. Everything's fine. Oh my God. And then you go completely ape. Nuts. Whereas the Morgan rage tends to be, I'm really ticked off. I'm really ticked off. I'm really ticked off. I'm like, you know, I don't get the pressure cooker so much because I'm always venting. I just let it all loose most of the time. So Hugh was like, oh, maybe I'm happy I have the Morgan rage. I'm not really sure. Because the Grant rage apparently is more like the Campbell rage. I haven't seen it and I don't want to see it. So how do our pets get frustrated? Well, pets can get frustrated by confinement. So think about all those poor puppy mill dogs. Oh my Lord, talk about stagnation. Those guys never see outside of a 2x2 cage. Excess competition in the pack. And I do see this at our house when we have anywhere from 7 to 10 or 12 dogs. The more dogs we get, the more competition there is, particularly at food time. Everybody's going to get fed, but they don't know that. So everybody is, jumping around, barking, trying to kill each other. Just too much competition. Lack of exercise. So those poor dogs, the people work all day long and they spend 8 to 10 hours a day in a crate. And then the people come home and they go, don't bother me. I don't have time. I don't have time. I can't take you outside to play. No, I got to get dinner. I want to relax. Don't bother me. And lack of human interaction. So kind of the same thing. You know, dogs are very social. They live in packs. They want to be part of our pack and they want us to be the leader of their pack. Even if you only have one dog, that dog wants you to be the leader. That dog wants you to be their soulmate. They want you to interact with them. So, you know, that's the great thing. When you come home at the end of a really bad day and your dog is wagging his tail and he wants to give you kisses because he needs that interaction. And believe me, so do you. So if you had a bad day, come home, snuggle your dog, give him a pet. You'll both feel better and you'll have a lot less stagnation. So chi or blood stagnation can be caused by excess cold. And we talked about this before, eating too many cold foods. And that's why we want to feed our stuff from the refrigerator, warm it up to room temperature. If it's coming out of the freezer or the refrigerator, get it up to body temperature. Excess cold weather. So think about how we move in cold weather. You know, you have to put on 16 layers of clothing. I think of the old Charlie Brown cartoon where he's got so many layers on, he can't move anymore. So, you know, and what happens, you can't move. So you've got all these layers of clothes and you're stagnant because you can't move and you certainly can't move fast. So yang deficiency, that's not enough heat in the body. We talked about that way back somewhere in like number 4 maybe. So you will get qi or blood stagnation if you have too much cold in the body, not enough warmth in the body. So chi or blood stagnation can also be caused by excess phlegm, and that's what we talked about last week, because if we think about phlegm, it's that thick, sticky substance, so it blocks the smooth flow of chi and blood. However, stagnation can also be the cause of phlegm. So if chi and blood are not moving and it sits there long enough, it's going to get stuck, it's going to start to dehydrate, and you get that thick, sticky substance. So the two definitely go hand in hand. So chi or blood stagnation can be caused by spinal misalignment, which can cause muscles to remain in spasm, blocking chi and blood flow. So this is one of the reasons I really, really like chiropractic, and I like to use it along with my acupuncture and food therapy. Because think about it. You take a misstep. You sleep wrong. You wake up and your neck is stuck to one side. And so all the muscles on that one side are in spasm. And until that gets released, everything is stuck. And you're not getting good blood flow to that area. You're not getting good nerve flow to that area. And that's an area of stagnation. So I see this a lot in animals. They come in and I feel along the spine and I've got these just rock hard areas of muscle on either side. Once we do a chiropractic adjustment and we get some motion back into the bones and turn the spine back into a slinky, then we get the blood and nerve flow going out to the muscles and the organs that are supplied by those nerves. So a lot of times when we see bladder problems, you know, bladder stones, which is really just another form of stagnation inside the bladder, commonly it is caused by a blockage up at the spinal cord. So the bones have locked into place, the muscles are all tense and locked in and not moving. They're not allowing good nerve and blood flow to get down to that area. So the organ doesn't work as well. The kidneys don't work as well. The bladder doesn't work as well. Cats with chronic constipation, the bowel is not working as well. So we need to go back and fix the spine, make it back into a slinky, and allow the blood and nerve flow to get down to the muscles and the organs that we're supplying. So cheer blood stagnation can be caused by trauma or accidents with bruising and pooling of blood. So, you know, just think about it for a minute. You know, you get kicked in the shin. Oh boy, now you've got a big old bruise. Well, that's an area of stagnation. That's an area where the blood pooled and it's not moving on. And so you get this nice big purple thing. And a few days later, it kind of turns green and yellow. And then finally it disappears because the chi comes along and moves the stagnation on. But you can have stagnation in an area that stays for a very long time. I fell off a horse March 9th last year, so that's 18 months ago, I still have a purple bruise on my ankle, and this thing refuses to go away. Now, if I was a smart person, I would probably be lasering this thing and doing acupuncture on this thing, trying to get it to move on, but it's still there. So when you have a trauma, and this is one of the things that we certainly see with people who are in car accidents, and then they have all these chronic issues. And it's one of the major reasons for people being on disability, being out of work, having chronic problems, because you have a trauma, you have an accident, you get that stagnation and it never gets moved on. So if you can go see an acupuncturist, get your diet in order, and help move that stagnation, the problems will be much, much less. So symptoms of stagnation. Pain, it can be felt in the abdomen. So if you've got stagnation, one of the most common areas for stagnation is the liver, blood stagnation in the liver. And so you'll feel that kind of tightness in the gut. The I'm hungry, but I already feel kind of full. I kind of have this pain right between my rib cage. I don't know what it is. Also in your joints, arthritis is a form of stagnation. It's a form of damp stagnation. And so that's pain in the joints, but it can really be anywhere in the body, anywhere where you've got something stuck. So if the spine is stuck and it's not being a slinky and it's all locked together and all those muscles around it are in spasm, you're going to have pain. That's a chronic source of back pain. And then anything below that area. So people with sciatica, that's a problem where the nerve comes out of the spinal cord in the lumbar spine, but it will cause pain all the way down the leg. So you need to get the stagnation to move on to get rid of the pain. So symptoms of stagnation, I love this picture. I found a great website. It's a human tongue, but still, purple or lavender tongue color. So anytime an animal comes into my office and the complaint is, you know, my dog has arthritis, he's got pain, he's having trouble getting around, I want to do something to help him other than using Rimadyl, Deramax, you know, some sort of NSAID. So one of the first things I'll do is I'll look at the tongue. Well, these guys are always going to have a lavender tongue. They may have a red tip, they may have red sides, but they're going to have lavender. And it may vary where it is on the tongue based on where the stagnation is. But we see just a beautiful purple or lavender color. And it is almost always there. It's really easy to see. It's one of the easier tongue colors to diagnose. Most of my technicians who are just learning about Chinese medicine, when I get a decent purple tongue, I'll have them come in and point it out to them, and they're pretty good. So if you think that your dog is having pain, for those of you with the Spaniels with SM, and they're having issues and you're having a day where you go, boy, I think he's really painful today, take a look at his tongue. His tongue might be lavender that day, whereas other days it's a nice healthy looking pink. So if you're seeing some purple in that tongue, it means you might be in for a bad day. So other symptoms of stagnation. Well, we talked about that, you know, that pressure cooker thing. So frustration, anger, aggression, emotional outbursts. So for people, you know, it's the Campbell rage. It's the, oh my God, I held it in. And now I just want to kill everybody who gets on my path. For dogs, we see it as aggression. So, you know, we get these dogs who, you know, they're trying to hold it in. They're really trying to behave. They are doing the best they can. It's just, okay, I'm well behaved. I was taught to be good. I was taught not to attack other dogs. You know what? That one just pushed me one step too far and I am gonna kill him. So, you know, we definitely see these aggressive dogs coming into our office that have this liver blood stagnation. You know, a lot of them, it's something that the owners are seeing at home. These dogs just are angry all the time. I also see in cats, you know, cats who come into the office usually are not real happy by the time they've been put in a box, put in the car. They're not happy about getting in the box. They're not happy about driving in the car. They scream all the way there. They don't understand why nobody is paying any attention to them. By the time they come out of that box, they are coming out as an octopus with 700 toenails and about 1,000 teeth. So, you know, it's a frustration. They're confused. They're annoyed. So out it comes. So those are symptoms of stagnation. You may also see lethargy, inability to move. Because remember, these are guys who don't have enough chi. They're not moving things on. So they're just heavy. And, you know, everything is just sitting there. So they might seek warmth if there's excess cold or yang deficiency. Because remember, we talked about too much cold can cause stagnation. So, you know, here we've got, now these are probably puppies that are just sleeping. But if these were two old dogs who were curled up with each other trying to get warm because there's just too much cold and they just can't stand it, you know, then we would say, you know, they've probably got some stagnation somewhere. They're really trying to suck warmth from each other. Other symptoms of stagnation, and this is the one that people see me for most often, tumors, lumps, bumps, and nodules. So any tumor or lump is a site of stagnation. So nobody wants tumors. Nobody wants bumps and lumps. Everybody wants these to go away. The most common lumps and bumps that I see are lipomas, which are fatty deposits. Now, they are not normal fat. They are abnormal fat. We've started doing work with stem cells at our office, so we have to harvest healthy fat, and from the fat, we harvest stem cells and then inject them back in for arthritis, so we inject them into joints, any kind of inflammation. It can be really helpful, but we cannot use the fat from a lipoma because that is not normal fat. It is abnormal fat that's gotten stuck in that area. I see the most lipomas in dogs that are fed dry foods their entire life because it's an area of damp phlegm that gets stuck and stagnant. The best way to get rid of them so far for me is to remove them and then feed to resolve stagnation. Can we get these lipomas and lumps and bumps to resolve using just food? Over a really, really long period of time, maybe. Probably gonna have to add herbals as well, depending on how long they've been there. Two Dobermans ago, my Doberman, when he was about 10 years old, the kids and I sat and counted and he had over 80 lumps on him, which most of which were lipomas. And I said, my Lord, I wouldn't even know where to start to remove 80 lumps on this dog. And if I did remove all 80 lumps on the dog, what's going to keep them from coming back? Well, that was prior to my knowledge about how to keep them from coming back. So I don't know what dry food I was feeding at that time, but I'm sure, you know, the dog was just on a dry dog food his entire life. He didn't get anything else because I didn't know any better. And he was a lipoma factory, along with a few other lumps and bumps that were worse. So we need to get rid of stagnation because we don't want these tumors, lumps, and bumps to even occur. So if we feed foods to keep things moving, we have a lot less risk of even developing these things. So how do we treat it? Well, we're going to feed diets that include chi tonics because remember, things need to move. So you can go back a few webinars to when we talked about chi. Most meats are going to be some sort of chi tonic. Pumpkin, squash, sweet potato, those were all chi tonics. And, you know, we've talked about pumpkin in almost every webinar because it's just one of those superfoods. And so it's got, you know, good fiber in it, and it's a chi tonic and a little bit of a blood tonic because it's orange, so we like it. But it solves a lot of issues, and we've already stated that we don't like pets to be vegetarians, so we're going to get some meat in there, whatever kind we're going to pick based on the yin and yang of the dog. So we're going to always have some chi tonics in there. So chi tonics include beef, chicken, rabbit, lamb, tripe, millet, oats, rice, pumpkin, squash, and sweet potatoes, to name a few. Okay, so it's webinar number 7. There you go. All right, so specific foods to resolve stagnation, and I gave us the temperatures of these foods because we have to remember to feed within the yin and yang. So if we have a really hot dog and we've got some stagnation, we probably don't want to choose lamb or venison, even though they treat stagnation, they may be too hot for that dog. Now here's the bad news. The only cold thing on that list, meat-wise, is crab. And I don't know about you guys, but if I had a 90-pound dog and I had to use crab as my meat source, holy cow, that's going to be a little bit expensive. Although lamb is not exactly cheap either. Shrimp, I don't know how many people feed shrimp to their dogs, but that's not going to be cheap either. So the thing is, you don't have to use crab as your only meat source. So maybe we're going to use some rabbit or some pork. Rabbit was a really good chi tonic and it's cooling. And so then we can add a little bit of crab to that, and that's going to help resolve the stagnation. I will say from my own experience with my own animals, I've never had to go to the crab. So that's good news because it is really pricey. And then, you know, when we're feeding a lot of seafood, we also have to be worried about the heavy metals and the mercury and whatever else is toxic in the seafood these days with, you know, oil spills and all that sort of thing. So chicken is fairly warm, but it's also inexpensive, although it's probably pretty high on the list of things that dogs like to be allergic to. So, you know, if you have a dog with a lot of allergy issues, chicken may not be the way to go. So other things that are going to be cheaper than crab, carrots, and they're nice and neutral and easy, and you can cook those into your stew. You can feed them raw as treats. Probably going to go through the digestive system a little bit easier if they are cooked. Mustard greens, not too many people feed them, but you can, and they're nice and neutral. Parsley, great. I love parsley. It's a blood tonic. It's neutral. It resolves stagnation. It gives them good breath. So parsley covers lots of ills. Radish, we talked about for draining phlegm. It treats stagnation. It's very draining. It's neutral. And if you remember from a webinar or two ago, I talked about my Doberman who used to go pick the radishes out of the garden because he really liked them, obviously had some stagnation. And if I think back, that's probably the same Doberman who ended up with about 80 tumors. So he was probably trying to tell me something. Watercress, nice and cool, easy to get. You can chop that up in the food. You can cook it in the food, however you want to do it. Garlic is hot. However, garlic is great for treating stagnation. It's antibacterial. It's anti-inflammatory, so great for arthritis. In order for the garlic to really be active, it needs to be peeled. It needs to be crushed and exposed to the air. You can cook it in the food or you can feed it fresh. Most dogs, it's a great appetite stimulant because they like the taste and the smell because it's really pungent and really strong. So, you know, particularly if you have older dogs who are not that excited about their food, although it's pretty rare to have a dog getting home-cooked food who's not excited about it. But garlic is a lot of times a good thing to kind of get them going a little bit. Okay, so some herbals you can use. You can use cloves. You can use coriander, ginger, turmeric. Those are all going to be more warming. Ginger, again, I love the fresh grated ginger. And I don't know if we've talked about congee, but that's one of the things that I use in congee for those animals that are sick and have an upset tummy. And we just want to be very gentle to the tummy. It's a cup of white rice, long grain white rice, one chicken breast cooked and minced, and about a half teaspoon of minced fresh ginger. Put it in a pot with 4 quarts of water. Cook it all day so that it boils down into a nice kind of paste. Excellent for animals that have had diarrhea, upset stomach. We're just getting them introduced back into food. For animals who really don't want to eat, animals in kidney failure, animals with cancer, anybody who's not really sure that they're excited about eating, they've got upset stomach from chemotherapy, radiation, anything like that. Congee's a wonderful thing, so I really like the ginger, and it's anti-inflammatory, and it resolves stagnation. So if they've got pain from, stomach issues or whatever, it's going to help move things through, so it's really good. Dill seed, I don't use a ton of that, but it certainly would be easy to get and sprinkle in the food. Vinegar, a lot of people love vinegar, so apple cider vinegar, it's cooling, it's antibacterial, it's anti-yeast. It changes the pH a little bit. So a lot of people feed a lot of vinegar. Just remember, if you're adding vinegar, think about the dog's taste. Don't torture them with too much vinegar. I think that people can go overboard with it a little bit, but very cooling and does help resolve stagnation. And then orange and tangerine peel, we talked about those before. Most dogs will eat, a little bit of grated, a little orange zest in their food, no problem. We used to have a pony who loved orange peels, which was kind of funny. I wasn't doing Chinese medicine at the time, so I never really thought about it, but it was also a pony who had a lot of back pain. And so he probably at that point was saying, I really kind of need something to treat my back pain, and it tasted good to him and made him feel better. So the kids just thought it was funny that he would eat orange peels, so they would always feed him the orange peels. Okay, so we want to avoid foods that cause cold and damp that injure the spleen, because we talked about, things that are too cold that are going to cause more stagnation. So we need to avoid the dairy products. Remember, they cause phlegm, and the phlegm can lead to stagnation. Dry or highly processed pet food. So, that dry food that's fed all the time, it's damp, it's got all those carbohydrates. So the refined grains and carbohydrates, sugars and cold foods. So refined sugars, most of our pets don't get much of that unless you're feeding that semi-moist food, which if you've been here for 8 webinars and you're here on webinar number 9, I cannot imagine that you are feeding semi-moist food anymore, or I really haven't done my job well. But the refined grains and carbohydrates in a lot of the lower quality foods, they're the types of things that cause stagnation. And I think that's why we're seeing so much arthritis in our old dogs now, and even old cats. I've got a lot of cats that we take an x-ray and they're just loaded with arthritis. And I think it's because they've been on chronic damp causing foods. We let our cats go outside where we live. We're in a safe neighborhood. The biggest problem is that the older folks across the street also have cats that go in and out, and they like to feed all the neighborhood animals. So they have bird feeders and feed all the birds, which is pretty funny because the cats sit under the bird feeders and it's kind of like a free-for-all. But all the turkeys come and also eat under the feeders, and the deer come and they graze and they eat the corn and the apples that are put out. But they also put out this really awful dry cat food. And so where do my 4 cats go? They go across the street and eat the kitty crack. And so now my oldest cat is limping and gimping, and she's so arthritic, and she does come in every day and eat her chicken. She will only eat chicken, so I think she's a little cold. But at least it's a good canned product that's a shredded chicken that's very healthy for her. But I know she's over there snacking on this stuff that is contributing to her arthritis. And you know, short of keeping her in the house, which results in some pee-pee issues, and we don't want to go there, you know, she's feeding her arthritis, and that's not a good thing. So you do want to get the pets, if they're starting to have a lot of arthritic problems, you've got to get that damp product out of there. So, what's next? Well, there you go. That was a good lead in, draining damp. What's damp? What are the symptoms of damp? And we just talked about a couple. What causes it and how do we treat it? So that wasn't too bad. That was a little bit quicker than last week. So if we have any questions, I'll be happy to take them. Otherwise, we'll head to next week.
Okay.
Oh, we have questions. Question. Okay.
And it's about the color of food. You mentioned pumpkin being a superfood.
Yep.
Do carrots fall into that same category, and does the color have anything specifically to do with it?
And do carrots fall into the category of superfoods as well? Does the color have anything to do with the superfoods? Well, carrots are not quite as good a superfood as pumpkin. They don't have the same fiber in them that pumpkin does, and they have a higher sugar content, so they have a higher glycemic index. So if I were going to choose between carrots and pumpkin, I would choose pumpkin. However, carrots are great. If you have a diabetic dog, you probably don't want to go really, really high with carrots, but you could with pumpkin. It has a lower glycemic index. And it's really interesting because we have miniature horses and they are pretty much by definition insulin resistant. They tend toward glucose intolerance and they founder, which is a rotation of the bones in their feet. And what's the one treat that they get every time we go to the barn? My mother shows up with 2 pounds of carrots and we show up with 2 pounds of carrots and we split them between the 5 horses. But the minis get lots of them, and they can be an issue. They're a high glycemic index. So we would be a lot better if we took out pieces of pumpkin for the horses, but you know, we're not going to do that. Apples would probably be better, lower glycemic index. So carrots are good. Like I said, anything orange or red is going to tend toward a blood tonic, although carrots are not a specific blood tonic. They're a great chi tonic. So I like them. I wouldn't go really, really high with them. Okay, that's what we got. So next week we're going to talk about damp and then we're going to do some more specific conditions. And we're also working on making a couple of cooking videos so that you can see Hugh in action doing his grinding and cooking and all the fun in the kitchen and be in our new kitchen. So that's kind of cool. So until next week, we'll sign off and see you then. Thanks for tuning in.
Thank you for joining us for our food webinar. Remember to follow us on all of our social media on Facebook and Twitter at ClaytonVetNJ. That's ClaytonVetNJ. Remember to visit our website as well for more information about how you can help your pet live a healthier lifestyle. Make sure you join us next week for the next installment of Dr. Morgan's Food Webinars.